I believe that clearly if you have a quantum system which is pre-selected and post-selected, there are two measurements. There is one in the beginning, one at the end, and then you want to think about it in between. Then there is nothing which can close as efficient as the spooled state vector formalism. So I don't know how much I will succeed to put here. There will be some paradoxes. In fact, my third lecture will be also kind of will be based on the two-state vector formalism. So it will be like two lectures. So I think maybe during these 2 hours I will succeed to put some ideas. And maybe some advertisement. There is another paradox based on two-state vector formalism, which is presented here, and pigeonhole failure of pigeonhole principle. There are some quiz. I don't know if you did you bring
it? Yes. Yeah.
If you remember my T-shirt yesterday, I think we have two or three T-shirts like this. This is boring. So this is kind of
maybe so just switch it
on. This T-shirt is a prize, and I think we have more than one for best solution. So they not necessarily have to be full, but they have to be. There always will be, I think, three best solutions. And the three best solution, you can get a T-shirt for kind of sort of answering some question about the pigeonhole paradox.
Please sit down.
And I also have another prelude to my talk, which is not related.
But just close it, it's not.
And which yesterday I gave. When yesterday I gave this, the small picture of the picture. And the quiz here too, there are some written quiz. So yesterday I gave one paradox to think about. No one came to me and discuss it, which I'm a little disappointed. Anyway, Andy told me it was the last lecture, so still there is a time. And here there is another paradox, which is somewhat related to the two-state vector formalism, because Ayn Aronoff found a formula which I think is very useful. I found it in 1990, and in one of the papers on two-state vector formalism. Since then, I use it for I think the fastest proof about the minimal time of evolution to orthogonal state. And you can get very easily, and this I will show now, how you can get out of this formula uncertainty relation, maybe also one of the very fast ways. And I think some people use it for some other, I think it's very simple and useful formula. But if you look on it and use it maybe not too carefully, then you'll get a paradox. And I think it's important to compare the paradox of yesterday to the paradox which I present here. So this is another paradox for you to think. So the formula tells us that if you take any kind of emission operator and apply to wave function, then there is a decomposition. You can decompose it to the part which is the same wave function and the orthogonal part. And it turned out that coefficients are very simple. Here it's expectation value of this operator, and here is the uncertainty. So I think very easy to remember, and this is universal formula, and it's exercise for you to prove it. It's a few lines. Now let's say just say h psi equal alpha psi plus beta psi orthogonal, and play with it. You'll get this formula. Now, let's say I got this formula, let's see how I get the paradox. Again, maybe some people will see immediately it happened. Never happened with the previous one, but happened with this one, so others think about, because unsolved paradox, I think, is much more, much better than solved paradox. You cannot learn more about it. But it's unsolved, and you're trying to think, and you make your understanding better. So let's go to this paradox. I have this formula, and I will prove to you something which is clearly wrong. That expectation value of any anti-commutation relation between any two operators is zero. Provided your Hilbert space is just two-dimensional. So like you have a spin half. Clearly, if it's sigma x and sigma y do not commute, and sigma x, sigma y anti-commutator, and sigma z, maybe up to I or something like this, clearly there are quantum states for which I sigma z is not zero. But I will prove you that it should be zero from this formula. So I have two operators, A and B, and I apply my formula. My formula, I just write it for apply A and apply B. Next, after I have this, I can calculate the following. Since I have A psi and B psi, I can write this expression. Just put one part on the left, and so here it's A psi, which is put on the left, and here I just put the conjugate on the other side, and so psi will give me 1, so I will get this expectation value, and what will come out of here, I will have this, so psi orthogonal give us 0, but psi orthogonal will still survive, and it will be multiplied delta A delta B. So this is the expression. Of course, if I have this expression, I can do the same. And here is BA and here AB. And if I already calculated, I don't have to work it again. I will get again expectation and expectation value. But here it's psi orthogonal B, psi orthogonal A, and here psi orthogonal A, psi orthogonal B. So now I look on this equation, and from here I can get first, I can get, I just rearrange. Essentially, so I take this and this, so one takes one minus the other one, and this is anti-commutator. So this disappears, because this one minus the other one, so this minus this one, so this disappears. And so I have only this, and so I have this minus this. Since this is just a conjugate, so I get the imaginary part of this expression. Now, clearly, the imaginary part of this scalar product cannot be more than 1. So if it cannot be more than 1, then I say that this value, the absolute value of delta A delta B, surely is cannot be, this is less than 1, and so I put 2 here. So I get the delta A delta B has to be bigger than 1/2 of absolute value of the commutator. And if you know about faster proof of uncertainty principle, please tell me. So I think this one is pretty fast. But now, this is general good proof, but let's look on a situation when we have in two dimension. In two dimension, what this formula says? We have operator, we get psi, and then delta A psi, this psi orthogonal should be orthogonal to psi. And of course, the same, this psi orthogonal B should be orthogonal to psi. In two dimensions, there is only one state which is orthogonal to psi. If there is only one state which is orthogonal to psi, so this scalar product is 1. The imaginary part of 1 is just 0. So if this is 0, then this is 0. So I will try, I'm not sure, I will just sent to Rodi the slide, so it will be there. So you will be able to see the slide and you'll be able to work on this part. And they have very different characters, the paradox of yesterday and paradox of this paradox. But we'll discuss it. Okay, so let's go to the to state vectors.
So, just one question.
Yes.
In three dimensions, how do you define psi orthogonal?
Whatever, I don't know. But the claim is that whatever, when I apply A psi to there will be always I can decompose to the psi and what's left.
Oh, okay.
It's some vector that is orthogonal to the right.
Yeah,
okay.
It's not. It's something what's left. It's good.
Okay.
So, two state vector formalism. It's a formalism. It's not new theory. No new kind of. It's equivalent to standard quantum mechanics. There are no new elements. There is new concept which helps to see many things. It's faster. It helps to ask questions and introduce a simple formula which you can. And it's based on this idea that in addition to this one state, which we all know, the Schrödinger wave function is go forward in time for preselection, we introduce another one which go from the post-selection. Because I say, well, we want to discuss system in between T1 and T2. And it's always, we cannot discuss it without post-selection, but it's nothing particularly interesting. We are looking for cases when there is a post-selection measurement. And the simple case is post-selection measurement is complete measurement, so we know exactly what happens there. And the claim is that as there is a wave function going forward, there is a wave function going backward. Maybe it fits just the talk in the morning, that the wave function is kind of a tool for description. So, and it's help us to all kind of things. Now we're saying that we have two things which can help us to all kind of things when we discuss system in between. And the claim is that complete description of quantum system in particular time is not the wave function. It's complete description of a pre-selected system is a wave function. But if it's pre and post-selected, it's two wave function. We need one wave function to go forward and one wave function to go backward. And in fact, I want to say that they are kind of very symmetric. Maybe there is a question in which says there is a symmetry, but from given the pre-selection and post-selection, there is no question. They all on equal footing and contribute equal amount of information of what is going in between. Now, maybe it's kind of to visualize this because we're used to one. And I want to kind of try to visualize the other one, what it might mean, this backward wave function. And this, I think, the most famous forward wave function is a two-slit experiment, and this is our wave function, which we just, we saw the only the moment trajectories, but now we can see the wave function. And I consider pre-selection and post-selection, so I have a source, and I have my detector which clicked there. And what I claim that there is a wave function going backward in time, and it's the same Schrödinger equation, only you change I to minus I. And you have this interference picture here. So this is a forward and this is a backward. Now, I want to say that it's also, everything has should have operational meaning, I think. Without operational meaning, it's not of much interest. So the first thing, the complete description, as I said, is two wave function. Every moment, like here, I say there is this forward and wave function and backward. And we need all of them together. In every moment, the complete description, this is two things. And they pretty much independent. They cannot be orthogonal, this is the only part, but they, otherwise, they are different. Because this fixed by pre-selection and the other one fixed by post-selection. You cannot post-select orthogonal states, so they, this is why they never can be free orthogonal in between. To visualize, as I said, if we have this wave function with this interference pattern, one of the ways to see this interference pattern, it's not like the experiment to put a screen and to put to see the points, there is another way. I can put a detector and try to move it and look on intensity of particles which come to this my detector. And I will see this interference pattern. So this is kind of an operational meaning, how I can see my wave function. I have a source constantly sending particles, and I put a detector in different places, and I see there are some places with maximum, some places with minimum. Now, how I can see this wave function? This wave function, it's not that the particle, this is detector, it doesn't kind of send particle. Any idea how I can see the interference pattern? What should I do? All I have to do is just to move my source. I fix my detector, so my post selection is the same all the time. My source is the same source. And of course, this is amplitude, the intensity of the detector. But I will see exactly the same pattern. I have constant source, it's sent constantly the same intensity. But depending on the place it starts, I will see the interference pattern. So this is the way how I can go to a laboratory to see my backward evolved wave function.
So just to clarify, post-selecting means you discard all runs of the experiment where the detector doesn't click.
Sure, correct. Pre and post-selected, I consider, sometimes I want to be interested in the lucky cases when I just happen to this. Sometimes I can say a real experiment that is very large ensemble, and most of them I don't get the post-selection, I disregard this, I don't look at these cases. I only look on cases when I got the post-selection. Then I consider what happened in between. Okay, so the standard one-way description. If the Hamiltonian is zero, so if I prepare psi, it continues to be psi. If it's not zero, then I have to make this unitary evolution. Now, sometimes it's of interest, but for most conceptual and all these paradoxes, I consider a simple case when there is no free evolution. Still, there are some kind of some measurement, or maybe here there is some interaction. But apart from this, in between, I just assume that there is no interaction, but it's not difficult to introduce it. But what's important, what's entered here, not what was prepared. Because sometimes in the literature people say print post-selected system, and they emphasize how it was pre-selected. This is not important. What's important when I consider particular time, which kind of wave function enters here. And so, let's say I consider a spin half particle with some measurement. I prepared up y, measured z, got up z. So this is forward along the wave function. Not to make a mistake, I can time reverse this wave function. There's a wave function, but I can look backward in time on this wave function. So here was a wave function up z, and time reverse, I can still look on the wave function. The time reversal of psi of t is essentially the same wave function. This is not the second wave function which I'm talking about. The second wave function is fixed not by this measure here, by this measurement. The backward wave function fixed by future measurements. So from here to here, this result, it's what here it's really the same. So it doesn't matter. But here it's sigma x equal 1, so it's up x. And the fact that I prepared sigma z up 1 doesn't matter. The backward wave function fixed basis. And the complete story is these two together. So I consider here these two together things. This is really the description of my system. It has both up x and up z. There's no uncertainty relation in this story. When I have print post-selected systems, there's no uncertainty relation. I can prepare x and measure p later, or a Lagrange, so I can know x and p together. It's only when I have pre-selection only that I can have uncertainty relation. Here I can know sigma x and sigma z exactly. No problem. So this is a two-state vector, and this is a proposal of this two-state vector formalism dealing with pre- and post-selected system. Describe it by this two-state vector. I prepare psi, I post-select phi, and I discuss in between it. My formalism is not a vector of one state, it's a vector of two states. So, important. It's not that if we kind of believe in becoming all kind of philosophical attitudes to what is really going on, it's not that I'm going to this time and ask what was it this time. It's somewhat different. I'm later, after the post-selection, that I know the post-selection. I'm with this post-selection, I'm in the world in which I got this post-selection. And then I discuss this thing. Because if I'm trying to discuss my past, what was there, kind of, before the post-selection, it's a different story. All this never happened. It's important that I discuss, essentially, always I discuss past. It's pre-selected, post-selected. How I can discuss this pre-post-selected now? Post-selected never happened. I can maybe speculate what, but in all this discussion, I'm later, after T2, when I know that what's happened T1 and T2.
So there's this error is going up and you're immediately heard this. How can you go?
It's time error, there are kind of discussion. I assume there is a time error go up. I prepare one experiment. Then there is something else, maybe somebody measure it somewhere, or I want to know what happened now, what at this time T. But then I wait and I perform another experiment. And if I get this outcome, then I start to discuss what's going on here. Later. So the first that I said was 1964, Arnold Berger Legovich. And this was kind of was a paper looking on time symmetry, because people said that quantum mechanics introduces maybe time asymmetry, and they said that quantum measurement are really time symmetric story. They consider what happened when you make a measurement between measurement, and was the first to introduce this probability of measurement in between. So here was a strong measurement, and they asked somebody else entered the room and made a measurement of some other variable. What is the formula? And they derived this formula.
So can I add a quick comment? So this formula you derive by just assuming standard rules and proceeding from the past towards the future. You get the same formula in Bohmian mechanics, where you just have one wave function propagating from the past.
Bohmian, Copenhagen. Everything. It's standard quantum mechanics. So they said there's no change. Completely some probability calculus, which in fact I had a proof, but I think the proof is here, but I'm not going to spend time on it. This is a proof of ABA. I don't think we should deal with it. I just want to maybe to use this formula to see some interesting paradox. So, for example, if I prepare up z and measure up and find up x, I ask what is value of sigma z here. As ABA rule easily says that value of sigma z here is 1. Sigma z is 1. First, it's kind of trivial because, of course, if we prepare sigma z up, then this measurement should give us also nothing happened to zero Hamiltonian. But also the formula will tell us this because in the formula we have to C equal, I ask what's the probability of get up Z. So it goes here and here, and here not up Z, it's down Z. But projection on down here gives zero, so we automatically get one. The ABL, we don't need the ABL formula to calculate this, but we can And if I want to ask about X instead, then the ABL formula in a similar way will tell us about X. Because now, of course, put X, then this one is zero. Because it's down up. So it's also one. So, in particular time, we know both spin in both sigma z and sigma x. There is a convention, sigma usually, in units of h bar over 2. There will be a question session, and in the question session, there is kind of a single question of this type, but there is a kind of much more complicated question when I want to pre-select my particle and post-select my particle in such a way that I will know all of them, which this kind of thing sounds difficult or strange. Clearly, we have only two directions of time, so it's easy to prepare up z, up x, but how to arrange that we can know all of them. But anyway, this is kind of maybe not a difficult exercise, but will help. This is how the two-state vector formalism, in fact, can help. We found this result in using two-state vector formalism. We published it without mentioning because it wasn't popular. We knew that if we mention it, it will not be published. We succeeded to publish PRL this kind of result. How to arrange pre-selection and post-selection, to arrange that we can now spin in three directions. Let's go to maybe paradox, which is a three-box paradox. Again, I prepare a particle ball in three boxes. Later, I post-select the particle in three boxes. And in between, there is kind of a strange situation that I can claim that one particle is with certainty in box A and also with certainty in box B. First, the formally, why it is in A? Because if I open box A, given this pre-selection and post-selection, so I pre-select, then somebody opens this, then I measure. If I don't get this state, A plus B minus C, which usually I can get, not too often, it's not orthogonal to A plus B plus C. So if I get one, then I discuss what's in between. So the claim is that all these cases I got this post-selection, it cannot be that my friend will not find a particle here. Because first, if he does not find a particle here, so this is a probability, again, you can use the ABL formula, or you can use maybe very, it's ABL formula, you have this term. This term is A plus B plus C, projection on B and C. This has really happened, that if I don't find it here, then I project it on what's left. So it will be projected on B plus C. But state B plus C is orthogonal to A plus B minus C, so the post-selection is impossible. So clearly it is impossible to find this post-selection and not to find a particle here. So in all these plain post-selected cases, if somebody in between open box A, it always be with the particle inside. But if you look on this example, A plus B, A plus B, there is a symmetry between A and B. Clearly, if it's correct for A, it's correct for B too. So if you open instead B, you always find it there. Don't open A and B, this is a different experiment. Opening one box, this experiment tells either the particle here or not here. If I open A and B, it's asking where is the particle. It's a different quantum experiment. Then I will never, there is only one particle, I will never find two particles. I might not find any particles, in fact. If I open both of them, it might happen. I will find nothing. It might be in C, given the post-selection. But if I open only one of them, I will find it with certainty. Now, the mathematics of this three-box experiment give us many, many paradoxes. Pigeonhole paradox is essentially also the same mathematics, and I will tell a little more, but it also has some more in... Okay. So this is what I said. If you open all of them, in fact, the probability with probability 1 over 5, it will be empty. You can use this formula, in fact. Opening 2, it's like looking at its heat. Now, there is a stronger meaning. There is this classical game which you can maybe see relatively easily. The semantics is very simple. You prepare this quantum state, and if you open, you have to find it. So, but you say, okay, is a strong measurement change the quantum system? So you cannot really say that the particle is here. And I want to say that there is a pretty strong sense in which this particle both here and here. So, the first thing is, if I look there, I will find it. This is the first thing. But there is more. One thing more is the following. If I look not just in one of them, in both of them, but with a single particle, I'm trying to make scattering of a photon on two balls. So the experiment, I prepare my preselection. I send a single photon to scatter. Then I look on my post-selection, and I consider only cases when the post-selection succeeds. And then I look how my photon behave. I will say interference pattern of scattering from two balls. This is kind of much stronger. It's not just I look here. The quantum particle will see two balls. It will not see a difference if I put a real ball here and a real ball here, or there is only just one ball, which is print and post-selection. Now, this is three box. Of course, if, for example, like this ball will close everything, it's kind of two slits, and the balls close a slit, this one ball close completely two slits. If I send a single photon here, it will not pass through. Pre and post selected ball will close two slits. It's not that I post select on the fact that my photon don't pass. I post selected on my shutter. This is a shutter. I put the shutter here. I have only one shutter, but with this one shutter I can close two slits. In fact, I can close n slits, as many as I wish. There is the formula is more or less the same. If you look, this is, if n equal 2, you see I will come to my three boxes, but two things which I can close. It will be the same formula. For n equal 2, it's come to this three box formula, but I can make it bigger, and then I can, by pre and post selection, I can send close as many slits as I wish. And here, so if I send a photon in superposition going everywhere, and I get pre and post selection on my shutter, I will get only a reflected state of the photon. It will see as everything, all slits is closed. Which is, I think this experiment has been done in Japan maybe 2 years ago. Okay. And this is why it works, but that's not that's not. I have maybe another kind of question for you, with another kind of paradoxical situation. Again, the same mathematics, three box. But instead of three box, I have three different states. I have one particle with a spin. And the particle can be here or here. I prepare it of being in superposition here and here, but in fact it's three states. In it's here with spin up, it's here with spin down, and it's here with spin up.
So the total Hilbert space has dimension 4?
In principle, yes, but I use only three of them.
Good, yeah.
I use only three out of the dimension 4. My pre-selection and post-selection, again, the same three, and the same kind of state, except that put a, here I put the phase minus. And now I claim the following. Projection operator on a spin particle here with a spin up is 1. I know that if I open here, if I look for a particle here with spin up, I will find it with certainty. Because it's kind of three boxes, and this is one of the places in the box, it's spin up here. Another place is spin down here, so I also don't find spin down here with certainty. This is an example of a failure of a product rule, because I know that, of course, the product of projection of up and down is 0. I know that here it's projection up, here it's projection down, with certainty, but the product is 0. For pre and post selected states, the product rule doesn't work. I will discuss it a little more in the following. But now the question for you, what will happen if I make this pre-selection and make this post-selection and make a Stern-Gerlach experiment for Z here? What should I get? Because I know the spin up with certainty and spin down with certainty. So what will happen if I put a Stern-Gerlach device here? So this is kind of another question. You're welcome to come to me. You understand? There's a pre-selection, there's a post-selection, and my question, you'll come with a measuring device and measure sigma z here. Okay. Yeah, what will happen in Stern-Gerlach experiment? Elements of reality and product rule. If we're kind of in a standard quantum mechanics, when we don't have post-selection, and this is a situation, no post-selection, then there is, I think, the Red Hat book, I think, pretty good book, I think. Because this elements of reality inspired by Einstein element of reality, that if you can infer with, predict with certainty that something will happen, so there is an element of reality. In pre- and post-selected situation, and for this element of reality, there is this product rule. If I know, if I measure A, and I will get A, small a with certainty, and b, small b with certainty, I know that ab will be also with certainty. It cannot be for pre-selection that they don't commute, because they have to commute otherwise. Now, for these commuting operators, if I have pre- and post-selection, this might not work. Now, for pre- and post-selection, I have similar elements of reality, but I cannot say predict. Because I have pre-selection and post-selection, it's kind of all in the past. I can infer. So I define that there is an element of reality when it can be inferred with certainty. If I can infer with certainty, like in this three-box experiment, there is an element of reality, the ball in box A. Why? Because I infer with certainty. If I look there, I will find it. And the same about the box B. So, but here, these things doesn't work. There is no product rule for elements of reality if they are pre- and post-selected. I think this kind of important observation, because there is this another paradox. I discussed this interaction-free measurement paradox. Lucien Hardy used it with made a twist, make two interaction-free paradoxes to make even stronger paradox. We have this tuned interferometer. You see, this interferometer is tuned that it should go only here. And this interferometer tuned that should go only here. One is for electron and one is for positron. This is electron, this is positron. Now it's arranged that if they send it simultaneously and if it go here, here they meet and they annihilate it with certainty. Not very realistically, but let's. So this is the setup. Now, this is interaction-free measurement. If I get a click here, I know I found a bomb here. What is a bomb? The bomb is my electron. Only electron can be here, nothing else. There is a positron, which is my experiment, and there is an electron, which I might find here. So if I find it here, I find that electron is there. So I know with certainty, electron is here. Now, if instead I get a click here, I know with certainty that the positron is there, because this is interaction-free measurement, and it found a bomb here. The bomb now is a positron. Now, quantum mechanics tell us that there is some probability, I don't remember, 1 over 16, I think, something like this, 1 over 12, that we'll get two clicks simultaneously. Standard, just make a calculation. Both, we can send electron positron together and get these two forbidden clicks. So you look on this interaction-free measurement, you know, oh, electron is there. You look on this, oh, positron is there. You know with certainty, this is true and this is true. On the other hand, by construction, if electron and positron are both there, they will annihilate. So I know electron is here, I know positron is here, I know that electron and positron are not here, which means this product rule doesn't work.
You allow interaction.
Yes. It's based on the, we arranged the experiment, here there is some kind of maybe cavity or something which made them strongly interact. If I send electron here, positron here, or they always annihilate. And still, but still you see they kind of can go around. Or they can, one can go here and one can go here, this kind of round. There are all these quantum options. And if you calculate, it might happen this click and this click together. So all this has not zero probability. And if this happened, then you will say that this is true, but also this is true. Now, Hardy made out of this kind of far-reaching conclusions. We assume realism, we assume that elements of reality correspond to Lorentz invariant observables. As themselves Lorentz invariant, we can derive a contradiction with quantum mechanics. Kind of trying to say, forget about the Lorentz invariant quantum mechanics, which is kind of far-reaching, which is incorrect. And he just looked on one Lorentz frame, this happened first, in another Lorentz frame, this happened first, so he had these two things, but then he combined them and he got the contradiction. But he didn't realize that it's all pre-imposed selected. For pre-imposed selected, he cannot use it. This doesn't have to be true. So there is no connection between. The product rule doesn't have to be true. This can be true. All these three things can be true together without problems. For pre-imposed selected system, the product rule doesn't work. And so there is no contradiction. So all this conclusion Hardy is that there is a problem is not there. So this was my answer. Okay. Maybe another peculiar example, which was implemented very recently in China. I can prepare an EPR pair and measure here sigma z for one of them, and for another one I measure sigma x. And I consider cases when all succeed. So I succeeded to prepare EPR, and here it came out up Z, and this is came out up X. And I want to discuss in between. I want to discuss here the value of sigma X of this particle. Now, what is the value of sigma X here? What it should be?
Plus
or minus?
The probability
device.
If I'm going to measure here sigma x, I'm not sure this was my belief. I asked here anyone similar. So let's ask about this. What is it? Well, if I measure sigma z here, what I will get?
Minus 1.
Minus 1, because it's an EPR, I got here up, so here it should be minus 1. Sigma z, it must be minus 1. Now, if instead I will measure sigma x here, since here it's up, I also will get minus 1. But if I measure the product, and there is a way to measure this product, and not simple way, it's kind of no longer measurement. I make a product of two variables which are far away. I measure this product without measuring this and without measuring this, only the product. And the ABL rule give you some calculation that the product of this is also minus one with certainty. So we had this with certainty, and this with certainty. And as you see, we have failure of the product rule with certainty. And this experiment had been performed in China with some hyper-entangled photons, whatever. I don't discuss the detail just a few months ago. It was published. Okay, so until now, I discussed this two-state vector formalism with all kind of interesting puzzles, interesting paradoxes. And they all were based on strong measurement. I think the most interesting reason to apply two-state vector formalism is what was done with my PhD with Aronov, when we considered the sprint post-selected system and we considered weak measurement in between. The strong measurement, first, you can relatively easily to use standard formalism, and not so difficult to get this. Maybe it's difficult to think about this, but this story, I think, it's much more profound. So the claim is, I already said that here in between, the description is this two-state vector, is this thing. But then there is this kind of very general property, which I think lately I found that it's, or maybe I anticipated it before, but now I put it in print, that there is a real kind of reality here for every variable, this weak value, which is a simple expression. It's reality close to eigenvalue. When we say that the system has an eigenvalue, we believe it's reality. And I believe this weak value is very close to this. Before, it was conditional expectation value, because a weak measurement had ensembles and was some. But now I say it's stronger than this. It's there is a real property here. Now, real, if we make in connection to my lecture yesterday, I believe that the only reality is a wave function. This is the only reality for God, or for physicists who want to think about everything, about all worlds together. We live in particular world, in a world which will get post-preselection and post-selection. For us, there are more kind of things which are real only for us. They are not real in physics to all of it together, but they are real for us. And these real things for us, it's this weak value, it's kind of a real thing for us. So it started with this, I gave some talk in some conference 1 year before in New York. The first, essentially, the first publication on this weak value was this measuring procedure for pre-selected and post-selected ensembles defines a new kind of value of a quantum variable which we call a weak value. Now, I put this in some compendium and put it somewhat differently, and now I really perform this other thing. The weak value of a variable is a description of an effective interaction. Because for me, I think The reality is how things interact with something else. You can define what it is in all kinds of ways. But what's important, if you go and see how your object acted on some other things. So this effective interaction to environment, this is really the reality for me. And I think that this weak value is like this. Of course, this explains also this. When I make weak measurement, then since it has this weak reality, it tells us how it affects our measuring device. So, first, how it started. So the weak measure as an outcome of weak measurement. This is how it was produced. This is a standard quantum measurement. We have a pointer. The pointer should show the good pointer, it shows zero. It has coupling according to one of Hamiltonian interaction, and we have our variable as superposition of three eigenstates, C1, C2, C3. And when we make a measurement, the quantum mechanics tell us that there is this entanglement. And then there is a macroscopic look on our pointer with macroscopic amplification, and we see one of them. So the first entanglement, and second, what we see collapse, so what I say, I entered in particular world. And so this is a standard measure. What is a weak measurement? Weak measurement is supposed to be exactly the same device. I don't change the device in any way whatsoever. I use the same Hamiltonian. So, first, I use it. If standard measurement, probability for this outcome is this. I also can find expectation value if I repeat it many times. And I will get some expectation value. So, weak measurement. Weak measurement, I use exactly the same device. But there is a philosophy. The philosophy of Aronov, he always talks that he wants to find really the property of the system. And when you make a strong measurement, you destroy the system, you disturb it. So we have to make something which do not disturb the system. So not to disturb the system, Hamiltonian should be around zero. If Hamiltonian is around zero, then nothing will happen to the system when you couple to it. So this is a philosophy of weak measurement. How you make this Hamiltonian around zero when I don't want to change the device? I have my system with some operator, I cannot do anything about it. My device, this is Hamiltonian, I also cannot change it. The only thing which I can change, this is a conjugate to the pointer variable of the measuring device. I can play with the initial condition of my measuring device. I can arrange that this is small. In standard measurement, this is really very big and uncertain. Not really expectation value, very not big, but it's very uncertain. With very high uncertainty, because my pointer was very well localized, so the momentum was very uncertain. So I have this Hamiltonian of standard good measurement is big, very big and uncertain. I want to change it, I want this very small. So I still keep it around zero, but I want uncertainty also around very small. So I cannot now start with a pointer showing exactly zero. I can start with a pointer showing on average zero, but it must have bigger certainty. So my pointer from the beginning, even without any coupling, if I look on it now, it can give me all kind of values because it's not shows well to zero. But the evolution works as before. So if I have this state and I have coupling, this is what's happening with evolution. My wave function all will move and they all entangled with my system. So after the coupling, I will get this interaction. And now I make post-selection on my state. I don't look at the pointer. I make pre-selection and I make post-selection, particular other state. After the post-selection, now they're entangled, but after the post-selection, they are not entangled. So I will have a pointer in some pure state. It turned out that the pure state has center in some interesting position. This interesting position, I can find it by averaging, but this interesting position is this weak value with a simple formula. It's always come out here. So I use standard measuring procedure, I make post-selection, pre-selection and post-selection, and in turn I look, then I look at my pointer. Again, looking only once on the pointer will not tell me much because it's very wide. But I repeat the same pre-selection, the same post-selection, so I can find this weak value. And the center of the distribution, this is a weak value.
Could you say again, what is the condition that you post-select on?
Particular state. This was one state, this is another state. So, and in the moment, this state is pretty much orthogonal. Not very different from this one. Then this weak value can be very far from the eigenvalues because it's, where is the formula?
What is confusing is that this final value is not some linear combination. What you said just now, of these eigenvalues, how can it?
Fortunately, I had to put this formula someplace here. Yes, this is a weak value.
The weak value is not a linear combination of eigenvalues.
It's not in between because it's divided by scalar product, which might be very small, and it may be complex because of the scalar product. But because this in principle it's a complex number. But in the beginning, when I say that my weak, when I talk about pointer, it really shows the real part. I will talk more tomorrow about the imaginary part. But so this is kind of. This is a formula, very simple. And operationally, in this, you perform measurement, and the center of the distribution of the pointer will sit around. Again, if it's very, very wide, it will sit here with very, very high precision. But if it's more or less wide, it will sit here pretty well. So the center gives weak value. To find this weak value, we need an ensemble. We have to repeat it many times, and we'll find the center of the distribution. Now, if we want to find some, if this sigma x equal 100, this means that the coupling is stronger by 100. So if it's all these things, it's the center of the distribution is far away. And this might be useful for amplification. And really, what kind of little citation of this paper for a while, but then Kwiat succeeded to measure spin Hall effect for light, some very tiny effect which no one succeeded to see. But using this amplification, it was kind of seen very clearly. And since then, it became very popular. People saw some angle of mirror, which after some picoradian, terra, but very, really kind of extreme precision. So it worked, especially this imaginary part helped, because when you look at imaginary part, you look at some conjugate, and this some physics will allow you to see it easier, so to get some big advantage. Also, there was kind of big 2PRLs with this distinction saying that this is completely wrong, and this added maybe far to the kind of discussion. So many, many papers on this weak value business, it's still controversy, but I think it's almost 2,000 citation in Google Scholar. So it's, and there is a weak values in Physical Review. There is a weak value weak measurement section. So I think it's made its way to. It's established now, not like real thing. Okay. So now I want to talk about some more understanding and also recent experiment toward my understanding that these weak values are not just, let me see how much I have time.
Yeah, like 10 more minutes.
So
including questions.
concluding question?
Yeah, maybe we can say 15 more minutes including questions.
It's a strong or weak statement.
then I start it by saying it's... I think it's... Well, I didn't start like in the half, well, no? Because the break was later,
yeah.
So I think it's... So 25 minutes if it's later. So
okay.
So that's... but we'll see. I don't try to... I hope there will be questions, so maybe I'll skip some. So weak value is a property of a single system. I want to say that this is really a kind of real property. This is a complete description, and maybe here is a one-line proof. What's important for me, as I say, is how it's coupled to environment. If I have coupling of this pipe, and C is an eigenvalue, then and B is all kind of everything else. So my Hamiltonian, I have to replace it by a C number. And then I know what will happen to my environment. It's just the C number C times B. The claim is, did I have pre-selection psi, post-selection phi? And let's not spend time on the proof. The claim is that when I have pre-selection and post-selection, and I look at it infinitesimal time, then what really happening? That effective interaction is I have to replace my operator by this weak value. Sometimes it's maybe interesting, this weak value might be complex, so I can have effective non-emission Hamiltonian. Or it can be much bigger, much smaller. For a very small time, it might be everything else. C is my operator, it's my coupling through C. And this coupling for infinitesimal time is efficient, is worked like this. Now, maybe kind of an example. If I have a charge here, it gives some electric field here. So I can look on some pointer, maybe some charged particle or some, and look at what's happening with its momentum during infinitesimal time, it will be shifted. According to this field, let's say the value of the field here in some units is 1. So I will get kind of shift 1 here. This is if it's eigenvalue. Now, if I have expectation value, I want to say that it's better than expectation value. If I have an expectation value 1, how I make this 1? I put a superposition of charge more close and more far away. And ask, what about this field? I put my weak device, and so this weak device will move. Part of this will move according to 1.5. This one will shift it stronger, and this one will shift it quicker. So it will be this kind of move. Now it's kind of mixed state, because there is an entanglement between my measuring device and my charge. So there is kind of a density matrix, but kind of the distribution essentially of my pointer is some place here. Not too different from the eigenvalue. Now we consider a particular case on weak value. I want to make it dramatic. So I want to get weak value 1 here. Again, it was 1 eigenvalue, 1 expectation value, I want weak value 1. But I don't want to put my charges here. I will put my charges on the right. This should supposed to give us fields which are negative, because now the field is different direction. It's a superposition of this one and this one. So I started with particular preselection here. I end up with another particular preselection also here. Preselected, post-selected my particle in superposition here. And I consider my coupling here. So I can again, since the particles on the other side, they push the pointer differently. They push here and they push here. But because of the minus sign and whatever, when I make this post-selection, this superposition of this Gaussian will give me this picture. And my claim that this picture is much more close to the eigenvalue than this one. And we did some... with Jan, did some calculation which calculated quantum measures and showed this, and we also made an experiment which how you distinguish it, it's something which is very, the change was very small because it was weak coupling, so there's not much change. And how we make the how we can compare things which are very close, if they're the same or not the same. I was trying to say that the eigenvalue and weak value is the same. The eigenvalue and expectation value is slightly different. What we did, we made an interference. If things are the same, they should get a visibility 1 in principle. But this is, so we look, we work hard to get maximal visibility. And so we send once different states. And first it corresponds exactly to this Bure's angle, this quantum information measure. So this was a way to make this experiment, to see an interference. And this is, so we send one's eigenvalue, and here's the expectation value, I didn't show the result, but we show that weak value is much more close to eigenvalue than expectation value. So the reality of print post-selected system is this weak value. I can say that there is a reality. If I have a print post-selected system, this electric field minus one, you believe that if I have a particle here, it put here as a field one. I put a particle here, print post-selected, it gives you the same. If you, for infinitesimal time, there is no difference. You will see as if there is a particle here which pushes in this way. So this weak value, which are sometimes very anomalous, very strange. Electric, if I put particle here, the electric field should be negative. But pre and post selection can make it positive, can make it as imaginary, if I want. So there is this very useful theorems, connection between weak value and strong measurement. So maybe I'll skip it. So we just will make, again, I think it's very useful, so maybe let me just state it, especially if I don't. I discussed about these elements of reality, and even pre- and post-selected element of reality. Something I know, I have pre- and post-selected system. If I measure, I know I will find it with certainty. Like I know that I will find my ball with box A with certainty. I can also make some weak measurement of the projection operator. There is, I think, important theorem which is used now in few places and I think can be used effectively in more cases. If I know that something will happen with certainty, so I have this element of reality, the strong element of reality, and I make a weak measurement, I will find that the weak value equal to the eigenvalue. The strong measurement that I make a measurement of an eigenvalue, I find it with certainty. So if I try to measure it weakly, in this case it's pre and post selected, maybe it's, and I will find it, it maybe I didn't pre-select it in A, I didn't post-select it in B, I post-selected in A plus B plus C, A plus B minus C. But if I look in A, my weak value will be this something which I'll find with certainty. It will be 1. Projection of in A will be 1. There is also frequently important thing is if my variable is dichotomic, like projection, it also works backward. If I know that my weak value is 1, I know that it's elements of reality. If I try to measure it, I find it with certainty. This was how we found this result of sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. We really found it through weak values. We found that how to make sigma x, sigma y, and sigma z weak 1. And then we know that this print post selection will give us, if you measure sigma x or sigma y or sigma z, you will find it with certainty. So this is kind of very useful theorem. And if we apply it, for example, for 3 box, together with, we have this, in A, projection is 1. Therefore, weak value is 1. In B, projection is 1, so the weak value is 1. In we know for weak value that A plus B weak is equal A weak plus B weak. So from the fact that this plus this plus this is 1, this is for certain. Clearly, there is one particle, the projection of all of them should be 1. So the weak value of projection of all of them should be also 1. Now, this weak value is 1, this weak value is 1, this one, we have this since. Now, the sum of weak is equal to the weak of sum, the sum of weak, weak of sum equal sum of weak, so this is also 1. So now I have this equation, and I can derive that the weak value here is minus 1. In this three-box experiment, the weak value here is minus 1. If I try to measure projection here weakly, I will get minus 1. What it kind of means in some Gedanken situation? If I have ensemble, large ensemble of gas, of particles, all pre-selected like this, all post-selected like this, sitting in these three boxes. I will come with kind of a measuring device which measure pressure. Measuring pressure is a weak measurement of measuring the presence of a particle. I will find the pressure here as if all particles are here, because it's here's projection is 1. I will find here the pressure as if all particles here. Again, pressure 1. I will find here the pressure minus 1. I will get a negative pressure. This is weak measurement, sometimes get negative values. But here, using this kind of formalism, I can immediately, without calculation, tell you that in this situation, I will try to measure place pressure here, it will be minus 1. I think I will stop here.
Some non-local measurement in all three boxes, it will be also 1. Because this measurement of minus 1 in C is not a real measurement.
That's a real measurement.
Yeah, but you cannot, measure and obtain the pressure minus 1.
What's the problem? The pressure, if you put something here, and the pressure will push it. It will pull it. So this, you know, local measurement, this is kind of not practical.
So very difficult. This is a local measurement on C.
Local measurement on C. You come locally here and measure the pressure. And this pressure will be minus 1. No local measurement is very... No local weak measurement is something I worked on so that you cannot do it at all. Then Steinberg did something, and there are some kind of... But it's not easy. Non-local weak measurement, they don't exactly go together, because non-local measurement requires very strong correlation, and then weak measurement allows weak kind of uncertain, big uncertainty, so it's not easy to put them together. But here it can just, don't look well here on the presence, which is like measuring pressure, and you know, instead of here, these things will be kind of pushed out, and this will be put in.
There is no connection between boxes. There is just quantum correlation, something like
there is a pre-selection and post-selection. So in fact, every particle here is kind of separate. Every particle will put some small negative force instead of pushing. You put here, if it's, let's say, protons, you put another proton, instead of being pushed, it will be slightly pulled. But again, your proton shouldn't be in a very well-defined momentum position, because then it will be strong measurement. It should be in such a way that you don't, it's on average, you'll see this pulling. So it should be able to to tell you if there is a particle or if there is not. But remember, that this weak measurement is, this one will not tell you. Many, this is essentially ensemble. You repeat this weak measurement, and then on large ensemble, you see that all your pointer was very wide, but it's shifted. Because there are many, and then you see, okay, I get this minus 1.
So you said that weak bodies could be imaginary as well. And so in this example, can you have imaginary pressure? And if yes, what would that mean?
You have to play with coefficients to put maybe I here, it will be enough, I think. Maybe C minus IC, and then it will be... the meaning of this is the following. If you put here a weak measurement, then let's say you have proton here and you have proton here. The proton gives a small momentum here. So when after the measurement, you see the influence here, your measurement of the presence of the photon, it will be the change in momentum of the proton. If your weak value is imaginary, you will see that there is no momentum shift. Momentum will not be changed. But then you will see, look on the position of your meter. And you'll see that your position will be shifted, will jump. What will be changed is a position. The conjugate of momentum is a position. So there will be no kick, but there will be shift. And not like shift, if you have momentum, it starts moving, after some time it will be shifted. No. Immediately after the post-selection, the wave function of the of this proton will be shifted. The wave function is kind of white thing. So it was it coupled, became entangled, then post-selection. This wave function will be shifted. So imaginary give you its change in the conjugate value. Yes.
My notions of pre and post selection are a bit vague, so could you clarify what those exactly mean?
In standard, the sigma x experiment, I start with a photon, I put polarizer, I go through a polarizer, so my photon have very well defined polarizer polarization. Then I have coupling, the coupling usually is a bidirectional material, which depending on different type of polarization shifts slightly. Then, so my beam kind of slightly shift. And then in the end, I put another polarizer. And I look on on this polarizer. I can also split, polarize here and polarize here. And I can look now on the position of my beams. There was a coupling in position, and there is a pre and post selection in polarization. So another thing I have is interferometer. In the end, it can go this port or this port. So if this one post selection, it's another post selection, but it's a different kind of states.
Since we're a bit behind schedule, I would suggest we stop here the discussion, or anybody could continue over lunch, and then the exercise session would start at 1:45, so about 1 hour. Thank you very much, Dave.